Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
So I'm going to get down on my knees and I'm going to ask God to come and teach us and the Holy Spirit to be our teacher today. So if you're able to stand, would you join me as we go before the Lord in prayer and stand to your feet? Father, we come before you, Lord, and we thank you for the opportunity that we have to be here. Lord, on this weekend before our nation's birthday, Lord, we just take a special moment to say an extra thank you for blessing us to be here in this great nation. Lord, we thank you for this place where we can come and freely worship without fear of persecution. Lord, when people are imprisoned and tortured every day for reading and speaking of Jesus Christ, Lord, today, here we are unashamed in the house of God. Lord, we thank you for this. Lord, we thank you for this great nation. Lord, as we celebrate our birthday coming week, Father, we thank you that you would bless this nation. Lord, we ask that you set your hand upon our leaders and our elected officials. Lord, that you would guide them to make the right and the wise decisions concerning the will and the way of the Lord for this great nation. Lord, we thank you for it. And Father, we thank you that we have the ability to come into the house of God to hear the word. Lord, we don't come to hear from a man or to hear from a woman. We come to hear from you. And if you fully acknowledge that it's Jesus that's the senior leader of this church, and it's in the name of Jesus, we ask your Holy Spirit to be our teacher, to be our counselor, our guide today, to show us the word of God and plant the seed of God in our lives, Lord, that as we walk out of this place equipped and empowered to be your church, Lord, that we would bear much fruit for your glory. Lord, we thank you for all of these blessings that you've given to us. We don't ever think of ourselves as better than anybody else, but as co-laborers in the body of Christ. So, Lord, we thank you for our brothers and sisters all across the world and today across the Inland Empire that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you for all our denominational brothers and sisters. Lord, we thank you for our Catholic brothers and sisters, for our local churches. Lord, we thank you for Harvest and the Grove and Sandals. Lord, we thank you for the Well and the Way. Lord, we thank you for Ecclesia Christian. Lord, we thank you for Emmanuel Baptist, Crossroads. Lord, we thank you for Oak Valley, Abundant Living. Lord, all of our friends and brothers and sisters in the Lord, Lord, working together to build your kingdom for your glory. So, Father, we thank you, Lord. To you be the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said, amen. Amen. Now, I'm excited for the first time to be, not for the first time, but for today, the first time today, to tell the message because I'm excited where we're at. See, Hebrews in the 10th chapter. If you've got your Bibles, go with me to Hebrews in the 10th chapter. The way if I could paint a picture of Hebrews the 10th chapter, I would really say that this is like the package on the bow, that we have gone through a lot of Old Testament learning to understand the priesthood of Jesus, to understand the sacrifice, to understand what was done for us. And Hebrews chapter 10 really kind of ties it all together, really wraps it up, and then concludes with this message of faith and holding on. And then we get into Hebrews 11 chapter, which is going to be phenomenal when we get there, speaking about the hall of faith and learning about that, such an important aspect of our lives. But today, I'm excited because I really believe it's an important message. It's a message that each and every one of us live. When I say live, it means that if you're not going through it right now, you will. And you already have gone through it, likely in the past. And many of you, like myself in this place today, are going right now through what we're talking about today. So I'm going to give you the title. And when I say I'm excited because Sabbath and first service are personality-wise a little bit more conservative. So you got to really watch it. So I kind of gave them the PG title, and I'm going to give you the PG title. But then I know some of you like the edgy. Some of you really like to get in your face. I'm gonna bump it up one step. So the title of today's message is Kicking the Devil Out of Your Life. There's far too few of you that are excited about hearing about that. So let me give you the PG-13, because maybe you'll be a little bit more excited about that one, all right? Kicking the devil's butt out of your life. So if you're edgy, you can just put an apostrophe S right after the devil and the B-U-T-T, and that's the title that I have in my heart. So, but in order to encompass a broad spectrum of personalities, we'll just keep it a PG. So today, Hebrews the 10th chapter, we're looking back at verse number 11. Pastor Dan was there a couple of weeks ago with a message called The Expectation of Christ, and we were looking at this for the past few weeks. You can go online, take a refresher, listen to the messages online, or watch them. But here we are in Hebrews the 10th chapter, verse number 11, and the Bible tells us the author of Hebrews begins to talk to us about this, and it says, "And every priest stands ministering daily and offering repeatedly the same sacrifices which can never take away sins. By way of not taking too much time and means of review, because we've got a lot to discuss, if you recall, we talked about the priests every day or every year or every month had special sacrifices for the sins of man, but they could never remove the sin from the man. They could only cover the price of that sin, the price meaning blood. We talked about that in Hebrews, the 9th chapter, the weight of our sin. So it was never able to remove the sin. So the priest, I love how the action word here is the priest stands in a position of standing, in a position of wariness, in a position of ready. And if you look at the action words out of verse number 11, the priest stands daily, repeatedly. So you get this image of this never-ending, ongoing, continually on and on and on duty of the priest in the role of the high priest. But then in Hebrews, the 10th chapter, verse number 12, the author of Hebrews begins to shift to the idea of Jesus. And I love what it says. It says, but this man. This is speaking of Jesus Christ, our great high priest. But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down at the right hand of God. I love this, speaking of the contrast. Think about it like this. When you're at work, you're doing something, maybe you have a desk job where you're working and you're sitting all the time, maybe you're at a job where you're on your feet, or you're moving, or you're walking, or you're carrying something, whatever it might be. Some of you can relate to this. You've got maybe a spot at home. I've got a spot on the couch. Maybe you got one of those chairs. Some of the men in the house, is any of the men in the house, you got one of those chairs? You know, it's your chair. You know what I'm talking about? You know what I'm talking about? Because it's that chair that you got to put a blanket over because it's so worn out that like the padding's come. Because that's like you sit in that. That's like nobody else is allowed to sit in that chair. When I come home, One of the things I do, I'm kind of famous for with my wife. She knows whenever I've come home, is I don't like to wear business attire. So when we work at the church, we wear this. But when I go home, it's like I walk in the front door, and it's like the shirt's starting to get unbuttoned, kicking the shoe off on one side, on the other side. And by the time I make it to the couch, there I am in my shorts and my T-shirt in my one spot on the couch. It's my chair. But I like to sit in my chair. Why? Because the job is done. I am at home. Relaxing. Anybody relate to that? You say, man, I get home, I'm going to sit in my chair, I'm going to sit in my seat, I'm going to sit on my couch or lay on my bed, whatever it is. There's a difference between standing daily, repeatedly, and sitting once and for all, because Jesus came and paid the ultimate price and finished and completed the job. And now he sits at the right hand of the Father because the job is done. Amen. But this is where it really gets good, is in verse number 13 it says, from that time, waiting till his enemies are made his footstool. Waiting till his enemies are made his footstool. So a footstool, if you say, what is a footstool? A footstool is like an ottoman. If you got a lazy boy, or one of those couches or those chairs that you pull the lever and then, you know, the feet come up, that's a footstool. Like you know what I'm talking about. You like to kick your dogs up, rest them for a little while because they've been barking at you all day. You know, for me, I don't have a footstool. I have a coffee table. It is reserved for that. So, but here we see his enemies are his footstool. Now, in many cultures around the world, not so much in America, but in many cultures around the world, to place something underneath the foot is the biggest disgrace that somebody can do. You might even recall there was a really, really interesting image. I remember back when we were, I think it was Operation Iraqi Freedom, and the Allied forces had gone through Iraq, and there was a picture of a guy when they were pulling down that statue of Saddam Hussein. There was a picture of that one guy, and he took his sandal off. Does anyone remember that? And he was just like beating the statue of Saddam Hussein with his sandal. Because that's a really big disgrace in many cultures around the world. The bottom of one's soul is the most disgraceful position or place that anybody can be. And see, the Bible paints the picture that Christ's enemies are underneath his feet to serve as the rest or the stool in which he props his feet up, because the job is done. So the devil, praise God, the enemy is under the feet of Jesus. Can we all understand that one? Cool. Now, if you've got your Bibles, go with me to the book of Colossians. Let's go to Colossians in the first chapter. Colossians in the first chapter. A couple pages back from the book of Hebrews is Colossians. In Colossians in the first chapter, There's a couple really neat verses that I want to just kind of drive into the message today so that we can all be on a solid foundation for where we're going about kicking the devil out of our life. So Colossians in the first chapter, verse number 18, it says that he, speaking of Christ, see that capital H right there? He, speaking of Jesus Christ, is the head of the body, the church. So look to your neighbor and say, the body. Look to your other neighbor, say, that's me. We are the body. Okay? Can we all get that? Jesus is the head. We are the body. Where are the feet located? On the, you're like, huh, Pastor Luke, is that a trick question? No, it's not. The feet are located on the body. Nobody has a foot on their head, right? So you even said a statement like, you even heard it said like this: we are the hands and feet of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Right? So here Jesus, the Bible paints a picture that Jesus is the head, we are the body, and the feet are a portion of the body. Now we just read in Hebrews that Jesus is seated at the right hand of God, waiting till his enemies are made his footstool. He has already conquered or already brought victory over his enemies, but now you and I are the body or the feet in which the enemy is underneath, and we are the vessels that bring victory to the body of Christ or to Christ. Does that make sense? Is everybody on the same page? So if the enemies of Christ are under his feet, and the Bible tells us that Jesus is the head and we are the body and thus we are the feet, that means that the enemy is under our feet. We got it? Are we there? Cool. Now look at this. Go page over to Colossians in the second chapter. I want to take it one step further. Colossians in the second chapter, one page over. I love how it talks about this. It says, verse number 15, having disarmed principalities and powers, he, speaking of Jesus, made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it, speaking of his victory on the cross. So here it says that Jesus not only defeated the enemy, but made a public spectacle of it. You see, once again, we live in a culture that we don't want to offend. We don't want to upset or unravel culture. So when somebody steps in, that if they remove a dictator, if there's something going on, or there's a rebellion over here, that they kind of step in and under the table kind of try to put somebody that was elected for the people, by the people, and so forth. And we want to keep it you. Well, it's not us, it's you. But let me take you back to the culture of what this was when this was written. When two armies or two forces or two kingdoms would come against each other, the losing king or the losing general or the losing leaders of the army would be made spectacle in front of the victorious army. Oftentimes what would happen is the army would march either home, or they would march through their conquered kingdom, or through the main city or the capital of the conquered kingdom, and in front of the marching army, the victorious army, would be the defeated king, or the defeated general, or the defeated leader, seated on a donkey, paraded naked through the streets, as people would spit, as people would throw vegetables, as people would boo, as people would harass, as people would humiliate, a spectacle as this victorious army came in that they would show. Let me take you even one step further. In times older beyond that, when an army would go to battle with one, oftentimes the victorious party would take the heads. That's right, the heads. They would cut the heads off of the losing battle or the losing army's king or general or leaders, and they would display them on the outskirts of the cities, or they would pile them up as people would walk by as a means of putting on a humiliation to that losing party. Think about it like this. When David defeated Goliath with the rock and the sling, he didn't run over to the Philistines and, I'll put it there, let's call it even. David ran over to Goliath, cut his head off with his own sword, and held it up and cried, and the children of Israel chased after the Philistine army because he made a public spectacle. So now we see that Jesus Christ has brought the victory once and for all. He is the head. He is the preeminence. So that word we saw in the 18th verse means the superiority. There is nothing above Jesus. Everything is below, and we are the feet. So therefore, Jesus has the head. He has made not only victory, but he has brought public spectacle. spectacle and shame to the devil. So imagine it like this. The end of World War II, the big great ticker tape parade through New York and all the cities as the confetti's flying and everybody's marching. Imagine the heavenly places as Jesus has just come from the ascension from earth and now is seated at the right hand of the throne. And as he's walking through the heavenly places and everyone is rejoicing, the angels are crying out and there's confetti and everybody's rejoicing that it's finally done. It is finished. The job has been done. And now behind Jesus is the devil being publicly, being a public spectacle in front of the heavenly places, dragged, humiliated, embarrassed. Jesus saying, hey, here's the devil who thought he had power. Here's the devil who thought he had dominion. Here's the devil who thought he had rule, who thought he had reign, who thought he had control. And look at him now. Jesus Christ made a public spectacle of the devil. I love that. In Matthew, the 28th chapter, I'll just put it up on the overhead. They call this the Great Commission. Jesus, as he's talking to his disciples, says, all authority has been given to me. Jesus has it. Where does he have it? In heaven and on earth. Where do we live? Where do we want to go? Jesus has all, not some, not partial. I've got the authority, but there's a devil over here doing his thing. All authority has been given to me. Taking it a step further in Matthew, the 18th chapter, Jesus tells his disciples that whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. So question, is the devil seated at the left hand of God in the heavenly places? No. Jesus said, I saw him fall like lightning. He's cast out, has no authority. So if it's bound in heaven, guess what? Let it sink in. You got it. If the authority, the presence, and the power of God is loosed in heaven, guess what? Yeah, you got it. All right. So, Jesus has the authority. We are the body. Therefore, the devil is under our feet. So what this all means to you and I is that we are in a time of spiritual warfare. We are in a fight. That's why I said in the beginning, some of you are living this, some of you are not right now, but you have or you will. Sorry, you will. You can't escape it. We are all in a spiritual fight. But the problem is, we don't fight. The fruits of the Spirit are love, joy, peace, long suffering. So, you know, if I can just endure, if I can just survive this challenge, the devil's trying to beat me up. Let me tell you something. The fruits of the Spirit, one of the fruits of the Spirit for you and I as Christians is long suffering with each other. But can I tell you something? There's somebody you do not have to be long suffering with. And somebody needs to tell you the truth. You do not need to be long-suffering with the devil and the attacks of the enemy. Does not mean God's desire, and you'll see this in a moment, is not just for you to survive the attack. You are not a punching bag that after a while the devil will get bored and move on. But oftentimes we sit and think, well, if I just endure this, if I just hold on long enough, the devil's going to leave me alone and he'll move on to someone else. When the reality is that the Bible, we just read in Hebrews, the 10th chapter, verse 13 says that he is waiting for his enemies to be his footstool. And guess who makes his enemies his footstool? We do. We are that vessel, which means that we have got to fight. I love what Peter says in 1 Peter, the 5th chapter. 1 Peter, the 5th chapter says to be sober, to be of right mind, to be of clear thinking, to be vigilant, meaning don't waver, don't slack off, don't be lazy in your relationship or in your fight. Why? Because your adversary, look to your neighbor and say, my enemy. Look to your other neighbor on the other side and say, your enemy. Can I share something with you? We all have the same enemy. The devil hates you. I know that might hurt your feelings. I don't want anybody to hate you or hate me. I know, he hates you. Sorry. We all share the same enemy. So the Bible says to be sober, to be vigilant. Why? Because your adversary, your enemy, walks about like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. I think Peter was so smart under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit to describe the devil like this. Why? Because what do we call the lion? Does anybody know the nickname for a lion? The lion is the king of the jungle. The lion is the king of the jungle. I've had the privilege of going to Africa on a mission trip, and we got to go on a safari, and we got to see the lion, and we got to see them in their natural habitat, not just behind the bars or behind the glass, but to really see them in person. And you know, the interesting thing is in the natural scope of things, the lion is the top of the food chain, which means that there is not another animal roaming the jungle or the plains looking to eat a lion. The lion, the only thing, this is kind of neat, but this is socially or politically incorrect. The only thing that is the lion's enemy is man. So you can say, hey, you know what? I'm a lion hunter. Okay, all right, that was a little tender. We're not supposed to hunt lions. They're endangered. So let's take it one step further. So the lion, so Peter paints the picture that the lion is the head of the food chain. So here he says the devil is this big top dog, top cat. I remember when we were in Africa, we saw the lions, the pride of lions. Did you know that when the lions were laying there in the field, there was not an animal anywhere near them? We saw thousands of zebra in a herd. We saw rhinoceros. We saw water buffalo. We saw gazelle. We saw impala. We saw all these different African plain animals, the animals of the plains. And did you know that not one of them was near the lions? Do you know why? Because they're sober and vigilant. They know that if I want to be dumb, I'll go eat the grass next to that pride of lion because he's seeking whom he may devour. So you and I have got to be wise to understand that the lions are there. Hey, listen, you know what? There's a threat there. But look what it goes on to say. Because the devil walks about like a roaring lion. Do you know how lions hunt? Lions, let me share with you because you're like, you're kind of looking at me like a cow at a new gate. So let me just show you how lions hunt. Lions do not I'm going to eat something today, just roaring and walking around the plains and expect like a zebra to just be like, oh, just fall over and there it is. It doesn't work that way. They don't hunt like cheetahs. They don't hunt like leopards. They don't hunt like tigers. You know how lions hunt? Their skin or their hide is the same color of the grasses of the plains. And they crawl on their bellies in the afternoon hour when the sun is low and the shadows are cast, and they sneak up behind their prey. To within yards, to within feet, silently waiting. And finally, they jump and they pounce and they go after their prey. But one more thing. Do you know who lions target? Do lions target the biggest bull of the herd? Do lions target the biggest mama of the herd? Do lions go after the biggest elephant of the pod? No, you know who lions go after? Lions target the young, the old, the sick, and the weak. So here the Bible paints a picture of the devil, a roaring lion, sneaking up from behind, waiting, seeking whom he, do you see how it says whom he may devour? Did you notice how it doesn't say who he will or who he will devour? May signifies there is opportunity. Seeking, hey, I'm going to go after them. But there is a chance because that may is there that the devil will not reach its prey. Why? Because you and I are to be sober, to be vigilant. When the devil creeps up behind us and tries to pounce on us with an attack, can I share with you? Let's take the zebra's model and kick the devil in the throat. All right? He may roar like a lion seeking whom he may devour, but can I share another fun thought with you? Jesus pulled his teeth. He ain't got nothing on you and I. So, whom he may devour. So, the question for you and I is, how does the devil see us? Because a lion's not going to go after the strongest. It's not going to go after the biggest. It's going to go after the weakling or the old or the sick or the young. So how does the devil view us? Does he see us and see opportunity? Oh, well, they're young in their faith, so I'm going to go after them. Oh, well, you know what? They've gotten really comfortable where they're at, and I think I can get. Or you know what? They've been sick for a long time. I'm going to just take them out of the game. Or you know what? They're weak. I've been punching at them, and I've been gnawing on them, and they're just not ready to take it anymore. When the devil sees opportunity like a roaring lion, he will take it. But the question is, you and I, how does he see us? The answer to that is that we are in control. You got to get this, church. We are in control of how the devil views us. You say, God, I need you to remove the devil. I need you to take this away. Lord, I need this. And God says, I have given you everything you need through the grace of God to be empowered, to be emboldened, to fight that lion so that he does not see you as weak, as busted, as disgusted, as taking you out of the game, but rather he sees that he's going to have a fight on his hands if he chases after you. So today, let's talk about, in the next 15 minutes, let's talk about kicking the devil's butt out of your life. Kick the devil out of your life. If you've got your Bibles, go with me to the book of Ephesians. Ephesians in the 6th chapter, such a fun segment of scripture. Paul the Apostle, we call this the armor of faith, or the armor of the Lord. So today, Paul the Apostle is talking to the church, talking to you and I. I want to just go through this, and let's just grab some thoughts out of these statements that Paul the Apostle is writing to the church. Ephesians in the 6th chapter. Ephesians in the 6th chapter. Let's begin today in verse number 10. Ephesians 6, 10. Paul starts off by saying, finally, my brethren, this is an exhortation to the church. He's saying, listen, I'm getting ready to finish up this letter, and I want to give you an exhortation. Before I tell you what I'm about to tell you, I'm going to exhort you. I'm going to encourage you. I'm going to build you up. And here is the exhortation. Here is the building of Paul. He says, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Very important. Remember how I said the devil looks for the weak, the old, the sick, or the young? Remember that? And I said that it's up to us to determine how the devil views us. I love how Paul the Apostle says to be strong in the Lord. You and I, in the eyes of God, through the grace of God, are the big bull of the herd, or the big mama of the herd. The devil wants to come and try to take our babies. If you've ever seen that video, the Battle of Kruger, I will get my family and I will go punk that lion and get my baby back. Is anybody there? So Paul says to be strong, but not in our own ability. The fight, the spiritual fight that you and I will endure and will go through each and every day of our lives is not based on our ability to fight. Got to get it. It's not based on how strong you are. It's not based on how mentally, how you can endure mentally through hardship. It's not based on any of that. It's, Paul says, to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. When Paul talked about the thorn of the flesh, he said, God spoke to him, Christ said, that my grace is sufficient for you. My strength is made perfect in your weakness. And Paul went on to say, I would boast, I will rejoice about my weaknesses and my infirmities, because now I know that it's not about me, it's about Christ. So we have got to learn, church, to be strong in the power of the Lord and in his might. Are you with me today? So look what he says in verse number 11. He goes on and he says, put on the whole armor of God. Got to get this. Got to understand this. That Paul the Apostle is exhorting the church and instructing the church to put on the whole armor. It's a package deal. We don't get to pick and choose what we want. Well, I really like the shield of faith. I really like the sword of the Spirit. Or I really like the helmet. But you know what? I don't like the belt thing. The breastplate thing is kind of, it rubs me the wrong way. He says, put on the whole armor of God. I remember when I was younger, I played hockey. And in hockey, you have to wear a lot of pads. Basically, from head to toe, you're covered with pads. Because there's a little 3.5-inch solid piece of rubber that when it comes at you or it hits you, it really hurts. Or there's some 210-pound guy that wants to clobber you. So you had to wear pads. We in the locker room didn't have a choice. Well, you know what? I don't want to wear my shin guards today. I don't want to wear my shoulder pads today. I don't need to wear my helmet. I'm a tough guy. We didn't have the option. We had to put the whole package on because they checked us because they don't want the liability of somebody skating or playing without the entire package. And Paul the Apostle is telling the church, it's not a pick and choose a la carte armor. This is a package deal. We've got to put the whole armor of God. And he goes on that you may be able to, listen to this word, stand against the wiles of the devil. Didn't say run. Didn't say to survive. He said to stand. He paints a picture of a pillar. As the winds and the weather buffet, the pillar, the tree rooted in the ground, does not move. It may sway from one way to the next, but the storm will pass and the tree is still there. Why? Because you and I will not, should not, cannot, do not need to run from the devil, but rather to stand against the wiles or the attacks of the devil. Verse number 12 goes on and it teaches us even more. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. Did you know that one of the most effective devices the enemy has against mankind is deceit? From the very beginning, the devil has used the same methods to ruin the lives of men. Thoughts, ideas, and suggestions. From the very beginning, the devil came as a serpent to tempt Eve. And you know what? He did not bite her and say, hey, I've got poisonous venom that I've injected into you. The only antidote is for you to eat that fruit. He did not come to Eve with a blade and say, hey, I'm going to hold this to your throat unless you eat that fruit. He said to Eve, if you eat this, didn't God say, you won't die, but your eyes will be open and you will be like God. He deceived her into seeing the other side, his side of what he wanted her to do. And it's the same exact thing. Paul tells us, the church, the battle is not against flesh and blood. It is not against people. We are not here to fight against brother from denomination to denomination. Well, they say this, or they don't do this, or they do this, or from party to party. Well, they're wrong, or we're right, or from person to person. You hurt me, or you always, or you never. Our fight is not against people. And if the devil can use his most effective tool to get us to fight and to bicker against each other and against ourselves, then what effectively he has done is gotten us to not even show up to the fight because we're over here busy bickering. So it says, we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places, the spiritual realms. Where did Jesus say he had all authority? Heaven and on earth. So here, our fight is against the principalities, the darknesses of this world that are trying to ruin our lives, to steal, kill, and destroy. And we have been given authority through Jesus Christ to carry out and to enforce his rule and to enforce his reign. That is where our fight is. Verse number 13 goes on. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God. Don't you find it interesting that in three verses, Paul says the same thing twice? Do you think that in Paul's extensive knowledge of birthing the first church and being the apostle that traveled the world in a time where we didn't have cruise ships and airplanes, on foot, horseback, and by boat, do you think that through Paul's extensive knowledge he knew the condition of the church, that he had to say this twice because they still wanted to do a la carte? So Paul warns you and I, we cannot just pick and choose the armor that we want, but rather it is a package deal. All together is what protects us and keeps us so that we can. Why? He says, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, having done all to stand. I love this, verse number 14, stand. Does anybody notice the central theme of what Paul the apostle is talking to us about right now? Stand. He's saying, church, stop running from the devil. Can I just get on my little soapbox? Hollywood loves to make these movies about, oh my goodness, the ghosts and the spirits and the woods and that girl, her head spun, or they walked on the roof, and they always paint this picture of some guy comes in his black thing and his white collar with his Bible, and all of a sudden this girl or this person is like, bleh, and the guy's like, ah! And you're at home, you're like, ah! Let me tell you something. Can I just share something with you? That's poppycock. Did you ever see anywhere in the Bible that Jesus, when he confronted the man with a legion of demons, when the father of the son, his son was falling and rolling into the fires at night, when his son was covered with the demons, did you ever see Jesus? Ah! No. Jesus saw the problem and he said, get out. Let me tell you something. Paul says, stand, to withstand, having done all to stand, stand, which means you don't have to be afraid of the nighttime. Oh, I heard a noise. Oh, my goodness. Let me tell you something. That, whatever that is, it's afraid of you. You just have got to learn to use it. So first of all, stop watching that crap. Secondly, start exercising your authority because you don't need to be afraid of the ghost hunter. Let me tell you something. Jesus Christ is the head. You're the body under your feet. Back to where we were, off my soapbox. Therefore, having girded your waist with truth. The first element of the armor of God, we call it the belt of truth. Let me share some interesting thoughts with you. The point of weight distribution on the human body is the waist. You can carry a lot of weight on your shoulders. You've seen people with backpacks, or you've walked around, you got school books or something like that, or you've seen people carrying like the yoke with water or things on their side. But the weight distribution, the point of weight distribution on your body is your waist. So the Bible begins, Paul begins with this distribution or the armor of God with the very first thing is the belt or the distribution of truth. I know one of the things I like to do is I like to go backpacking. I like to take my backpack, go into the mountains and spend some time. And in my backpack, because of the heavy load that I carry on my back, has a waist belt. And actually, on a backpack, if it's properly fitted, the weight of the backpack is never on your shoulders. That's stability. The weight of the backpack rests on your hips, on your waist, because that's where weight distribution is. You see, it takes the weight of the load of the armor, it takes the weight of the burden, and it places it on the biggest muscle group you have in your body. It places it on the biggest bones you have on your body, and it gives you stability and strength. So here, Paul the Apostle begins the armor of God with the belt of truth. The belt that holds the armor up and keeps it all together is the belt or the precept of truth. This is the foundation of the armor of God. Everything is wrapped around this. This is where the weapons are held. This is where the armor is attached. This is our foundation, the truth. Which means we operate, we live, we act, we fight by the truth of the Word of God. We don't live what the world says. We don't live what our thoughts say. We don't live what the society says. We live based on truth, that Jesus Christ is Lord and what the truth of the Word says about you and I. So then he goes on and he says, having put on the breastplate of righteousness. The breastplate is what covers the midsection. We call this the core. Did you know, Dr. Yolandi's on the front row, she can vouch for me. Did you know that your heart is not in your thigh? Am I right? Did you know that your liver is not in your bicep? You get what I'm saying? Everything is all together. This is called the core. This is what they call the vitals. Your heart, your lungs, your liver, your spleen, your kidneys, your intestine. They're grouped in a core area called the vitals. And the breastplate of righteousness, or you could say it like this, right standing with God, is what covers the vitals of our lives. So you want to cover your heart? You want to cover your life's vitals? Then it's standing in righteousness with God. In right standing with God provides you the protection of your vitals. You might be able to survive a wound on the extremity, but if you catch a wound in the vitals, you've got problems in your life. And God says, righteousness or right standing with me is what protects your vitals from attack. The breastplate of righteousness. Verse number 15 goes on. And having shod or wrapped or put around your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Does anybody remember that movie, Forrest Gump? Does anybody remember when Forrest Gump met Lieutenant Dan? Remember the advice in Vietnam that Lieutenant Dan gave to Forrest Gump? Change your socks. Remember that? Some of you guys are in here who are Vietnam veterans or you're servicemen, you understand how important your feet are when it comes to fighting the fight, because that is the way you stand. That is the way you move. That is the way you march. Some of these soldiers carry 100+ pounds of equipment on their backs, and if their feet are not prepared, or if they've got trench foot or rotten foot, or if they've got blisters or whatever it might be on their feet, they are not going to be able to stand, let alone to advance. So the Bible says to wrap your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. What that means is as you stand on the peace of God. You might be walking into a battle that looks scary. You might be walking into a fight that looks like you're not going to be able to win it. But let me tell you something. First and foremost, you've already got the victory. Secondly, you've got the peace of God wrapped around your feet that every step you take, you say, hey, I don't know what's going on, but I know the outcome of this because I've got the peace of God and my feet are carried by the gospel of Jesus Christ. The feet, the methods in which we stand and by which we fight. Verse number 16 goes on. Above all, I love this, above all, taking the shield of faith. So Paul the Apostle places great importance on the shield of faith. I believe this is one of the reasons why Paul said twice, put on the whole armor. Because if you see above all, you begin to put importance on one over the next. But this is a package deal. And he says, above all, taking the shield of faith. The shield of faith is the defensive mechanism in which you can hold up and block the onslaught of the enemy. See, we believe faith is believing in the invisible, not the impossible. It is not impossible for you to win the battle. Why? Because you have already won the battle. It may be invisible at present, but you will see victory in your life continuing on with the shield of faith. That is what we hold on to. And I love it. It says that you may be able to quench the fiery darts of the wicked one. It doesn't say deflect or to block. It says to quench. You know what quench means? To put it out. So here, get this image. Think of Braveheart. Think of Gladiator, one of those man movies. You know, my men, right? The guys, they put the arrow and they light it up and they shoot it up and you see, and there's this flaming arrow, right? And everybody on the other side's like, you know, it's a massacre on the other side. So you've got the shield of faith and you're holding. You don't have this arrow stuck in your arm that's on fire. It's quenched. It's been rendered ineffective, which means the shield of faith takes everything the devil has to throw at you and renders it ineffective. Well, somebody's got to be a little bit more excited about that. Because what I just told you is that all the devices of the enemy, when you use the armor of God, are rendered ineffective because of using them. And he goes on, verse number 17. And take the helmet of salvation. I love 1 Thessalonians, the 5th chapter, talks about the helmet of the hope of salvation. The helmet is what covers the head, the thinking. You see, you and I, we are renewed. We are a new creature, the Bible says. In Romans, the 12th chapter, says that we renew our minds, which means when you have an attack, the first thing that you and I do is we go to the worst case scenario. Oh man, it's going to be like this. This is. Oh, how am I going to ever? Woe is me. Nobody's seen it. Nobody knows the trouble. We go there. But the helmet of salvation says no. It's covering our head, covering our thoughts, saying you are no longer that type of person. You don't go to worst case scenario. You renew your mind according to the word of God, and you think what God thinks. You say what God says. You act how God says to act. You don't do that anymore because it covers our head. It covers our thoughts, the hope of our salvation. It dictates how we act and respond. And then I love this. And the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. The word of God. The word of God. I love this. Paul the Apostle gives us our one offensive weapon against the devil, and it's not anything but the word of God, which means, remember I said God gave you everything you need to succeed in life? In Luke, the 4th chapter, when the devil was tempting Jesus, saying, hey man, turn the rock into bread. You haven't eaten in a long time. Just eat there. You know, throw yourself over. Your angels will save you. Bow to me and I'll give you all the cities of mankind in worship to you. Jesus didn't respond to the devil. Oh man, my 40 days are almost up. If I just stay quiet, I'll just get through this. You know, he'll just keep punching at me like a punching bag, but eventually he'll move on. He didn't say to the devil, hey, get away from me, kid. You bother me. Jesus said to the devil every time, it is written. And he responded with the word of God. The Bible says to resist the enemy and he will flee. What is your resistance? The word of God. When the devil comes at you, you say to the devil, hey, it is written. When he comes at your kids, it is written. When he comes at your job, it is written. When he comes at your finances, it is written. When he comes at your life, your joy, your happiness, your legacy, devil, it is written. And you start punching holes in the darkness that the devil tries to bring, and light will break through in your life. Verse number 18. Praying always with prayer and supplication. Praying always with prayer and supplication. You know, no soldier as they go out is left alone, without communication, without some sort of orders, without some sort of directive. They're not just left to wander. There's constant communication back with headquarters on reports. And we have got to remember that even though we bear the armor of God, the prayer and supplication is the means by which we fight the battle. And now we can fight the battle to prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for the saints, which means prayer is how we fight our fight. We have always got to be in communication with headquarters, that is with God, with Jesus at the right hand of God, sitting, waiting for his enemies to be his footstool. Communication with God for ourselves, and he says supplication for all the saints, which means we pray for us and we pray for our brothers and sisters who are fighting as well, and we stand together. And Paul the Apostle says, having done all to stand, what do? We stand. We will win this fight. And in conclusion, let me just take you here. Pastor Dan was here a couple of weeks ago, but in 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter, the Bible says, but thanks be to God who gives us what? Victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Verse number 58 says, therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding. You know what abounding means? Moving forward at a rapid pace. Always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. The victory is ours through Christ Jesus. His desire, his will, his plan for us is to not run from the devil. It's not to survive the devil, but is to kick the devil's butt out of our lives. Did you guys get something out of that today? Speaking of, so amazing, because, you know, the heartbreak of losing something that you love for the lost is nothing like that to experience. And the truth is that God, his heart is broken over some of us in this place today because we're lost. More so than a pet, more so than a family member, God's heart is broken for some of us in this place. And I want to give you the opportunity today to examine your heart, to examine your life, to determine where are you with God. Are you lost? Are you in the kingdom of God? So let me ask you a question today. If you were to leave today and you were to die and your heart were to stop beating, let's just say that, and you were to die, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? You say, well, Pastor Luke, you know, I don't know. I'm not sure. I'm not sure that heaven exists or hell's real. Let me tell you something. Just because you don't see it, because you don't feel it, because you haven't experienced it personally, doesn't mean it doesn't exist. Just like right now, you don't see, you don't feel the microwaves and the radio waves that are going from me to the sound booth by the sound of my voice that you hear on the overhead system, but you know they exist because you can hear me. There are many things in this world that we don't see, we don't feel, but we know they're real. Heaven's a real place. Hell's a real place. Real enough for God to tell us about it, Jesus to teach us about it. Real enough for you and I to take it serious. So if you were to die today, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? You might say, well, I think so. Man, I hope so. I want to. I really don't want to miss out on that. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible, nowhere in the Word of God does it say that you can hope, that you can think, that you can want or wish your way into heaven? Like you've got the most positive outlook on life. The most willingness attitude that you're going to get into heaven. You're not going to get to heaven that way. Do you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you sit in church? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because your parents told you you're a Christian? Because you've given yourself the title or you profess to be a Christian? Nowhere in the Word of God does it say that because you volunteer in the children's or youth ministry or you sing in the choir that you're going to get into heaven. You can't get to heaven based on those things. Well, you might even say, well, I'm a good person, and I've always been taught, I've always been told that heaven is a place for good people. Good people go to heaven. Did you know that nowhere in the Word of God does it say that good people get into heaven? As a matter of fact, God says our good deeds are like filthy rags to his righteousness. Because you see, nothing you and I could ever do on our own would ever make us good enough to get into heaven. Because God's standard for heaven is perfection, and the only way we achieve that is through his Son, Jesus Christ. The only way you and I can get to God's heaven is God's way, and that's through Jesus. Jesus said this. He said that he is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one goes to the Father except through him. So today I want to give you that opportunity. I want to give you the opportunity to do it God's way. Jesus in John the 3rd chapter was discussing the subject of eternal life with the man by the name of Nicodemus. Jesus and Nicodemus were discussing this, and Nicodemus was a good man. Memorized scripture, taught it in the synagogue or the church of his day, gave to the poor, did all the right things, said all the right things. And you would think that as Jesus and Nicodemus were discussing this subject, that Jesus would say, Nicodemus, man, you just keep on going. But Jesus says to Nicodemus these words, you must be born again. What does born again mean? I know that you're thinking what Hollywood and society means of radical, crazy, weirdo, out of control Christianity, but let me tell you something. From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. In the eyes of God, born again means this, that you've given God all of your heart, that you've given God all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with God. Let me prove it to you. The Bible says in the book of James that the devil in hell and the demons in hell know who Jesus is, yet they're not on their way to heaven. It's not about your mental assent or your carnal knowledge of who Jesus is. You already know who Jesus is. That's why you're here today. But it's an all or nothing. Let me show you. In the book of Revelation, the last book of the Bible, Jesus himself is speaking to the church, and he says to the church, he's coming back. And when he comes back, he better find you hot or he better find you cold. Because if he finds you lukewarm, Jesus says, he will vomit you from his mouth. Shocking statement. And what Jesus Christ is saying is that lukewarm Christians are not real Christians at all and will be rejected and ejected from the kingdom of God. What does that mean to be lukewarm? I don't understand that. Let me define that for you. Lukewarm is simply put that you're a little bit in, a little bit out, a little bit up, a little bit down in your relationship. Occasional church attendance, token prayer. Doing some of your own thing, doing some of God's thing. You're not wholehearted for God. You're not wholehearted against God. Listen, you know, in any relationship in your life, romantic, business, friendship, whatever it might be, if you were to go to that person and say, you know, I'm only going to give you a little bit of my effort. I'm only going to give you a day or two a week. I'm only going to give you occasional thought. You know that that relationship would never succeed, yet we think that we can do that with God. Say, God, I'll give you a day a month, or I'll come here once every once in a while, throw out occasional token prayer and think that everything's okay, when God says, I want it all. I want all of your heart. I want all of your life. Say, well, how do we get there? Well, we can't get there your way. We can't get there my way or some well-meaning church committee's way. The only way we can get to God's heaven is God's way. We talked about that through Jesus. And Jesus says this, that if you confess him before men, he will confess you before his Father. But if you deny him before men, he will deny you before his Father. So today I want to give you the opportunity in just a moment. Here's what I'm going to do. In a few moments, I'm going to count to three. Like this. I'm going to go one, two, and the count of three. I'm going to go three. I'm going to smack my hand on my Bible real loud. And when I smack my hand on my Bible, here's what I want to do. I want to give you the opportunity. What I'm going to ask you to do in just a moment, all across this auditorium at the same time, I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is just saying, hey, Pastor Luke, I want to go to heaven. Pastor Luke, today I want to make sure. I want to give God my heart. I want to give God my life. I'm a man. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. And you can put it right back down. You say, man, if I raise my hand, I'm going to be embarrassed. I don't think I can do that. You might be. Let me share with you something. Don't let a moment of irrational emotion, embarrassment, stop you for making the very best decision you can make as a human being. This is the best decision you can make to choose eternal life with God in heaven. It's your choice. God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He's not going to force his way or make his way in. It's your choice today. It's a gift. So who should raise their hands? If you've never given him your heart, you've never given him your life, in just a moment, wherever you're at, get ready. Pop your hand up. Who should raise your hands? Maybe you're not sure. Don't walk out of this place without making sure. That's a gamble on your eternal life you can't afford to make. Who should raise your hand? You've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God's thing. You've been running from God instead of to God. Today is the day of your salvation. Come on, in a moment, just, if that's you, pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. And we're going to move forward in your relationship with God today. Today is the day of your salvation. All across this auditorium, from the front to the back, in the family rooms, wherever you're at, if that's you guys in a moment, get ready to pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. If you're watching outside the campus online or on the televisions, if wherever you're at, get ready. This is your moment. This is your time. I'm going to count to three. God is in the business of redemption. He wants to redeem you to heaven. It's your choice. Today, make that decision. This is the day of your salvation. I'm going to count to three all over this auditorium, wherever you're at. Get ready. Pop your hands up in just a moment. Be proud about it. We'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. We'll go from there. Here we go. Ready? One, two, three. Let me see those hands in this place. One, two, three, four, five, six. Six wise people, seven. I see you right there. Seven, eight back there. All right. Anybody else? Let me see if you raise your hand and I didn't see it yet. Nine. I see that hand back there. Nine wise people. Anybody else in this place today? I see them point. I got that hand back in the back. I already got that hand back there. Nine wise people. Anybody else in this place today? You say, man, I wonder if I should. I see the ushers pointing. Ten. I got you right there, my man. Ten wise people. Anybody else in this place? I got that hand already. I see you. 11. I didn't see you. All right. I got you, my man. 11 wise people. Anybody else in this place today? In the family rooms, in the foyer, wherever you're at. You guys all right with God? You want to make sure. Anybody else in this place today? 11 wise people. I don't want to pass you by. But I'm going to close this up right now. Anybody else? 11 wise people. Well, hey, praise God for the 11 wise people. Here's what we're going to do. From the front row to the back row, wherever you're at, you raise your hand. You say, hey, I want to do this. You don't get saved by raising your hand. You get saved by making Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior. We're going to pray together in just a moment. We're going to change destinies, but you got to do something about that. So in a moment, we're going to all stand. I want to ask, please, as we stand, nobody leave. But as we stand, Elijah's going to sing a song. If you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand, I want you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair, get into the aisle, and come meet me right here. We're going to pray together. We're going to change destinies together. So let's all stand. If you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand, come on, let's meet together right here. Let's change destinies. He's right here, right now. This is your time.
Jesus, I belong to you.
Congratulations.
You're the reason that I
come on, you can come.
You're the reason that I breathe.
You can come. Come on, you can come. It's not too late. Is that you? Come on. Come on, if that's you.
Jesus, I believe.
Amen. Well, here's what we're going to do. If they're coming, come on, we'll wait. It's all right. Come on, we got you. Here's what I want to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? His name is Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel is a really cool guy. He's going to take you right over there. Listen, I promise nothing weird goes on. I am as weird as it gets here at the church, and you made it through me. Simply put, he's going to take you right over there. He's going to pray with you. You're going to get saved. You're going to ask Jesus to be your Lord and Savior. So he's going to lead you in a prayer. Secondly, he's going to give you some free information to help you as you walk out of this place. What do I do next? We're going to point you in the right direction. Last thing he's going to do is he's going to offer you a friend. So you come back and sit with somebody, meet with somebody here at the church. They'll sit with you, teach you some things about the Word of God to get you strong. So like we talked about, you learn how to stand against the attacks of the devil. So if you guys just go right over there with Pastor Joel. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.